Well, good morning to everyone and a very warm welcome to the 10 a.m. virtual service here at St. Mary's. So today is the first Sunday of Lent. And of course, Lent is a very good time to be thinking more deeply about our faith. Maybe to challenge ourselves a bit, maybe to do something that costs us in some way, that requires some effort. It may be that you're giving up something for Lent, or indeed taking up something. And normally at this time, the church would run a Lent course, but for obvious reasons this year it's not happening, and the house groups are taking up the strain with who are studying a couple of books that have been recommended by our ministry team. But whatever you're planning to do this Lent, I would suggest that you prayerfully give it up to God and to acknowledge that He is the one that is the center and the focus of our lives. With that in mind, Brigitte will be kicking off a sermon series on the church as the body of Christ, and I'll leave that to Brigitte. I don't really have any notices this morning, but I just ask you to refer to the weekly bulletin that contains all of the important things that are happening in and around our church and our local community. So let's start off our worship this morning with our opening prayer. Merciful Lord, prepare us for this season of Lent. Help us to see the ways in which we have wandered away from you. Inspire us to rekindle our love and faith in you. May it be a grace-filled time of prayer and reflection on your love for us, drawing us ever closer to you. Amen. Now, normally this time I'd be handing over to Nathan, but this week we're giving him some time off, and we've got a couple this morning. We got Chris and we've got Co-Woon. Good morning, Chris and Co-Woon. Welcome. Okay. And over to you for our song worship.
Thanks, Paul. Yes, Nathan is having a well-deserved break. So this morning we're going to sing a couple of songs together. So in a moment we'll be singing Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me, which is a new song we haven't done before. But before that, we'll sing one that's much more familiar probably to most of us, which is Light of the World. So please do join us.
Together wonderful to me, and from heaven, Lord, how much it cost to see my sin upon the cross. And from heaven, Lord, how much it cost to see my sin upon the cross. And from heaven, Lord, how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. My joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to Christ. Oh, how strange and divine, I can say, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need power in his blood.
To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. All the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. I dread, I know I am forgiven, the future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my King. All the chains are released, I can say I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory water you. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet that I doth reprised in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I doth reprised in me. Yet not I doth reprised.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you, Kawun. We're going to have a time of confession right now. We're going to say a prayer of penitence together. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we're going to now have our Bible readings, and in between the Bible readings, we'll have our choir item. And we're now going to go to Mary, who's going to bring us our New Testament reading.
The first reading this morning is from the first letter of Peter, chapter 3, verses 18 to 22. For Christ also suffered once for his sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him.
Made all with a perfect heart. Good morning, everyone. Our gospel reading is taken from John chapter 17, verses 13 to 26. It is set at the end of the Last Supper, and the passage starts with Jesus praying to his Father for the disciples and continues as he prays for all believers. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world, any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Jesus prays for all believers. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them.
Thank you to Mary and Andy and to choir. It's now going to be my privilege to bring in Brigitte. And as I said at the beginning, she is going to start off a new sermon series on the church as the body of Christ. Good morning, Brigitte.
Good morning, Paul and everybody.
Can I just pray for you before you start? Would that be okay? Oh, I'm gone.
Thank you.
Lord, we just thank you for Brigitte, and we lift her up to you as she comes to speak with us. Lord, thank you for her preparation. Thank you for her prayer. And just thank you for her, Lord. And Lord, may you speak through her. May you use her for your holy will. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Paul. So we are here to start a new sermon series entitled The Church. Over the next 4 weeks, we are going to look at what is the fellowship of the church. What are the gifts the Holy Spirit is giving to the church? What are the ministries that help the church to grow in maturity? And we will look at the witness of the church. But for today, I would like to start off with something that to me feels a little bit like a foundation to all those four following sermons. The title for today is The Purpose of the Church. Or if we want to put that into a question, What did Jesus mean when he said to Simon Peter, his disciple, "On you I will build my church"? And for the thinking behind our sermons, we're going to look at the gospel reading, which Andy read to us from John chapter 17. In John chapter 13 to 16, we find Jesus sitting at the dinner table together with his disciples. Jesus is very well aware that this is the last time he will sit together with the disciples, and he wants to use that time to remind them of his most important teaching: love one another. And he wants to encourage them again with the promise of the Holy Spirit, who will come to teach them from now on, who will come to be at their side, who will comfort them. It is when we come to chapter 17 that there's a slight change seems to happen. Jesus is like turning a little bit away from the disciples and is instead looking towards heaven. And he says, "Father, the hour has come." Jesus is aware that this is the very specific hour. This is the hour which will divide history. It's the hour that will divide mankind. But Jesus is also aware that it is the hour which God his Father had appointed to be. To me, it feels as if at that moment, Jesus is like stepping onto a bridge from which he can look backwards into the past, and he can look forward into the future. When he looks back, Jesus can stand up and say, "Father, you've given me a job to do, and I've done it to the last little detail. I've fulfilled every bit you've asked me to do. I have sown the seed which you have given me. And as I'm coming to you now, Father, will you take care of what I've started? Will you look after my new friends on earth? Will you protect them from evil? Will you keep them in your embrace? Will you strengthen them with your word?" When Jesus looks to the future, amazingly, he does not look at the cross, which is just so close looming ahead of him. Instead, he looks into the far distant future. And it's as if in his mind's eye, he can see a multitude of people from all over the world, from all different centuries, all of them facing God, all of them worshiping and bowing down before God, all of them in a mysterious way, somehow reflecting back God's light, the amazing brightness of God's glory, reflecting it back to God. And it is at this time that there's something stirring in Jesus's heart, and he says, "Father, I have got one last request. I want all those disciples, all those who love you and who have received your love, I want them to be where I am going to be. I want them to be with us. I want them to see the glory we share. I want them to be part of the relationship we have with one another. Father, if three can be one, then surely a myriad of thousands can be one too. I was quite taken aback to start with when I read that Jesus says, "Father, I want." That's not how we often pray. But Jesus prayed with full confidence, "Father, I want what I know you want too. I know it is your will to bring everybody and everything together in oneness in your presence." And maybe it was easier for Jesus to pray with that confidence because he knew exactly what that oneness consists of. He had been there long before he came to earth with the Father in oneness with the Spirit. For us, it's a little bit harder to really understand what that means. I remember more than one Trinity Sunday service sermon where we were trying to grapple with how come that something is in it and something is in that and they are together in this. And it just, I still don't understand it really, not with my head. But maybe this is just one of those God things which were never made for our heads. One of those things which we simply have to trust that God knows what he is saying to us and God knows what he is doing. By faith, we can trust in that oneness. By faith, we can trust that God will create that oneness, even if we can't see it yet. And therefore, by faith, we can trust, because Jesus asked for it, that we will be a part of that oneness. Although maybe we can't understand it, we can find pointers to that oneness in John chapter 17. It makes an interesting exercise, and I would recommend it to you, to read through chapter 17, simply looking out for how many times does the word give occur. The Father gives to the Son gives to the Father, Jesus gives the Holy Spirit. It's just one dance of joyful giving and receiving and passing on and sharing. And it makes a wonderful read if I don't try to understand it, if I just listen to it and allow myself to be part of it. There seems to be so much joy in all that giving. Why? Because there are no barriers. There are no fences that sort of make a mark of what belongs to me and what is yours. It's all open, all one. It's all us together. And that is the oneness into which Jesus and the Father wants to invite us. And that's a church, Jesus said he wanted to build, and to build it on the foundation of the human, the very human Simon Peter. I believe that Jesus is in the building business right now. I believe with all my heart that Jesus at this moment, which we find so difficult and so challenging, is actually using our challenges to build us into oneness. Sometimes God uses great joys to bring us together as one. but sometimes he uses difficulties and pressure to show us that we cannot do it alone, to show us that we are dependent both on him and on one another. I found it really quite moving to listen to a nurse from one of the London hospitals who was talking about her experience of the last few months, of the stress, of the tears, and of the exhaustion. But at the end, she said, "But we as a team have come closer to each other through it all." If Jesus is building his church right now, how can we join in? What is our part? If we go back to John 17 and listen again, Jesus has asked the Father that we would be allowed to be in his presence, that we would be allowed to see his glory and to enjoy the relationship within that oneness. To be, to see, and to enjoy. Surely that can't be it, can it? That seems just too easy. Or is it? If we ask ourselves the question, where are we being? How are we looking, gazing, adoring? Can we really say that we enjoy and seek the relationship with God the Father every day, not just on a Sunday? Well, I know some people have used the open church during the week because they were looking just for that stillness to be, for that peace to simply enjoy God's presence. Many people go out into nature and love just watching what the new life of spring is showing us in new colors, new shapes, in beautiful movements. I have recently kind of been followed by some words of a worship song. Sometimes we sing, "It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise." It's God's breath in my lungs. Over the last few days and weeks, that has sometimes simply stopped me in my track. The realization that it's the breath of God the Creator, which I'm breathing with every single breath. And it's just put a huge amazement into me. I am breathing in God. Every time I breathe, surely that is a sign of God in me, me with God. It's a wonderful way of realizing that oneness. So when I read John chapter 17 again and again, I believe that the very first, not the only, but the first purpose of the church is to be in God's presence, to look at him, to try and see him around me and within me, and to simply dare to enjoy the oneness with him. Dare to enjoy that we can talk to him, we can listen to him, we can move knowing that he is with us, in us, by our side. And to know that while we do that, he is actually doing a work within us as individuals and a work within us as a church, as a worldwide church. Maybe it's unexpected that that is how Jesus is building his church, but it's his way, and it's, in one sense, it's got to be unexpected to the world. Otherwise, the world wouldn't take notice of it. And yet Jesus says, I want them to be one so that the world will see who I am. To me, it feels a little bit like a stained glass window. Loads and loads of small pieces of glass, each one a different shape, each one a different color. But each one put in a particular place by the artist. No one who travels to the cathedrals in France with their cameras is going to point out that one little funny blue piece of glass which is right in the corner and which seems so thin and so long. Everybody will look at a whole stained glass window and will stand and marvel at it and then praise the artist who made it. That's the church of God. The church which Jesus is building. And as we are standing at the beginning of Lent, I would like to leave you with a quote. I can't remember who it is from, but it's made an impression on me. The less we do, the more God can do. The less I do, the more God can do. It's probably worth thinking a little bit about it over the next few weeks. This is the foundation of the church, I believe. Over the next few 4 weeks, we'll hear more. But let's start with being, seeing and enjoying. Amen.
Thank you so much, Brigitte. We're going to go into a time of reflection now. And this week I've kind of chosen something a little bit different. I've chosen a song from Hillsong Worship called This I Believe. And the song is a form, of the Creed. And I think based on what Brigitte has just said and where we are in Lent, it's always, appropriate to think about what we actually believe in. And so it might be interesting to listen to the words and just get a sense of what this song's all about. And after that, we'll go into our prayers with Julie.
Jesus, our Savior. God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Name of Jesus. And our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God.
Let us pray. Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, you are the creator, the one who holds everything. You are maker of all things. How wonderful to remind ourselves of those statements this morning that are the very roots of our faith. I believe in God the Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. And so it is to you, Lord, that we come this morning to pray. We pray for your world. We thank you and praise you for all that you have created, the beauty and majesty of the natural world. We pray for those who speak up about matters of climate change and who are working tirelessly to prevent the continuous decline of our planet's natural resources and habitats. Grant us the wisdom to care for all the earth and help us to act now for the good of future generations. We give thanks for all who care for our own community and for our church,
for those who clean and care for the building, and to those who look after the Bothy garden and maintain the beautiful churchyard. We pray for your church. The Bible reminds us that the church is more than just a building or a gathering place of people. The church is a body of believers who confess Jesus Christ is Lord and Saviour. Help us to come into your presence, Lord, to remind ourselves that we breathe you in every breath we take. We are in you and you are in us. It is God's breath in our lungs. So may we, as part of your worldwide church, as part of that global stained glass window, be beacons of light shining in a dark world. May we be signs of hope in a world where there are so many feeling hopeless. And may we be united in our love for you. May there be unity in our diversity. Lord, we need your power and strength. Fill us, we pray, with your spirit of love so that we may pour out that love on those we engage with each and every day. May your gathered church glorify and honour you in all that it does. Father, we ask for your wisdom and guidance on all who have to make decisions on behalf of St. Mary's over the coming weeks and months. Be with them, we pray, and may they know your presence and your peace. We pray for our community, especially for those who are lonely and isolated in this extended time of lockdown. We pray that you would surround them with your love. Lord, we pray for those who are having difficulty managing financially day to day with all they need for their families. Father, we ask that you would provide, you would meet their needs, and you would break into their lives. We pray for those who have lost their jobs and ask that you would open doors of opportunity for them. Lord, we thank you that you make a way where there seems to be no way. We ask for your blessing on our community, and we pray especially for those living in the Copse and Dell Close. May they be aware of your love for them. And Father God, we lift up all those who are facing illness today. We ask that you would bring healing, comfort, and peace to their bodies. Calm their fears and let them experience the healing power of your love. Today we pray especially for Elaine Mead, for Diana Beschler, for Julie and Ben Kalman, for Lynn Alsop, for Linda Tippelt, and for Ruth Smith's daughter, Rosemary. And we remember and give thanks for the lives of those whose anniversary of death falls at this time. Sybil Franklow, Peter Norman, John Street, and Sue Ellis. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Julie, for your prayers and for bringing many aspects of our service this morning together. Our last piece of worship is going to be a hymn from the choir. It's called The Church's One Foundation. And after that, we'll have a closing prayer and blessing. Thank you, choir. Before we have our final closing prayer and blessing, I'd just like to say thank you to everyone who made a contribution this morning. And thank you to our tech team of Graham and William Rosser, doing a great job as always. Let's just close in a final prayer and blessing. May the Lord bless us and watch over us. May the Lord's face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look kindly on us and give us peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Thank you so much to everybody, and hopefully we'll see you again soon. Thanks. Goodbye.